Hello, and welcome to FQ Discover Margaret Sutherland's First String Quartet. We had such a great time earlier this year immersing ourselves in the music of Margaret Sutherland, and in particular this First String Quartet. We thought it might be a good idea to fill you in on some of our musical discoveries and help you understand some of her musical language, because it really is quite unique. Like Bartok, Margaret doesn't actually use a key signature for any of the movements, and in fact the harmonic structure almost defies having a key signature. Margaret went to Vienna, but like many British composers, and she was studying in England, like many British composers, she didn't really get swept up in the second Viennese style of Webern or Albenberg or Schoenberg. Her sensibilities were more along the lines of Bach's or Ireland, Hindemith, Debussy, and indeed Bartok in terms of harmonic influence. This string quartet was written in 1937, 1938, and it follows her very successful sonata for violin and piano. I do recommend that you look up a recording of that piece. It really launched Margaret's career. This piece, her first string quartet, was praised by critics for her independence of thought and her integrity, and that this work eschews romanticism and will upset conservatives, but will not be regarded as advanced by the ultra-modernists. And you'll hear that as we go through. This quartet is definitely an Australian landmark of the 20th century. And it is worth noting that when Peter Sculthorpe heard Margaret Sutherland's music for the first time in 1948, he remarked, "I felt this was my first encounter with a truly original and Australian voice." Now, the structure of this quartet will be familiar. The first movement is in a sonata allegro form. The second movement is sort of a slow ternary form. The third movement is a freely constructed scherzo. And the last movement is a sonata type, like finale. So you're going to be hearing many harmonic similarities with Debussy, Ravel, Bartok, and Hindemith. But I'm going to point out a few techniques that Margaret has used in order to find her own harmonic voice. And interestingly, the same technique gets used again and again. So we begin in the first movement, which this theme, which is shared between the instruments. And then the movement goes on. Now, we would expect a G there, but she gives us an A. And I was wondering what came first. Was it the tune, or was it the harmony? It's an interesting question that I often ask composers, but we have here a very solid G major harmony. So Margaret could have done this. She could have done that. She could have even spiced it up a bit and done this. Something like that. But she does this. And puts an A into G major. Now it's this interval of a second that we keep coming back to. So an A is one note away from G. And she keeps on playing with that. But if you put them right together like I've done there, then you can hear it's really atonal. If you spread it out amongst the instruments, so we've got a G down the bottom, and then we've got a D, and then we've got a B, and then we've got an A, that widely spread out. It sounds really cool. So that's our first little harmonic investigation. And it's this interval of a second, which is then spread out over the instruments and made in that second in a wider interval of, so the A is here, and the G is all the way down there in the cello. She uses that again and again. Now, in the very beginning, there, then we actually could be in A flat major. So we've got B flat, C, I can actually play the piano. We have that chord, such a cool chord. And again, she's put the semitone in the two widest instruments, E down the bottom, E flat up the top. If she'd done it like this, it wouldn't have been as effective. By the viola, like this. And Margaret does a really interesting thing where she gives us a little glimpse of it beforehand in the second violin. Which then goes into a cello recitative. We don't really know where we are, but Margaret brings us back into the recapitulation. Security. So just before the end, we kind of have this beautiful, what we think is going to be a C major moment. So we have the violins going. But what happens is that the viola whacks a C sharp. Whacks a C sharp in there. So it goes something like this. Then we end very squarely in C major. Whatsoever. Now, here you might be expecting it to be in D major or in G major. So we have believe it or not, she does B flat major. We have... Margaret has this harmony, which is really kooky. So she's got two lots of seconds, a minor second and a major second there, and she's got an E and a B, which, you know, you could say that is quite tonal, having a fourth. It's what she has done with the voicing, that she's put the C down here, the B is going to be all the way up here, and then we have the F sharp here and the E here, and so that's how she makes these sorts of harmonies work. Tune. We do revisit the opening tune at the end of this movement. We have actually quite a normal chord. So it's actually a G7 chord that the top three voices land on. Okay, and we've had a G just prior, so it does, we can say that. And so what we're expecting to do from a G7 chord is to go into C major. That's where we're expecting it to go. But Margaret winds us up into a frenzy. Somehow we wind up into that G7 chord, a massive pause, and then
thank you.
So what you heard there, that last chord, which is so utterly magical, it's actually an F minor chord with an E natural in there. But again, it's how she voices it. It's all in the voicing. So that minor, that F minor, is really disguised. The E is not up against the F, like that. The E's down the bottom. And in fact, the E's making a major third with that G sharp or A flat there. It's that voicing that's really magical. I'm just going to play that chord for you again so you can hear that voicing. Now the third movement is an amazing amount of fun. It's a scherzo, and I think it's a scherzo in the true sense that it is incredibly hilarious to listen to. It actually reminds me a bit of a Kurt Weill song. And look, there's lots of bits that we loved in this movement, and I just wanted to point out my favourite. When we were rehearsing this, Wenhong found a little bit that she thought was exactly like a dog barking. Unexpected silences and little twists and turns. Just have a listen to this one bit. Maybe some Brecht text going along with that in some weird way. Now, what I really wanted to show you was the last chord and what it might have been in lesser hands than Margaret. So Margaret actually has D minor. She has a cello very firmly in D minor. So that's what the cello is doing. The viola is playing just octave A's. And then we have, so very much, D minor. But of course, in D minor, you need a C sharp. You need that. So I don't think I can actually quite play. Oh, there we go. There you go. As if there are all the notes there. So really, anybody else might have just ended in D minor. But Margaret added in that second. And again, she put the C sharp right at the top. Long, long, long way away from the cello D. Now, the last movement has two things that kind of keep on coming back. The first is the opening theme. That's how the first violin starts. And then the other three answer with this rhythmical figure, which actually permeates the whole movement. So it goes, if I can play the actual parts, like that. The second theme is introduced by the second violin. Second theme goes like this. And underneath that is a sort of like a I guess you'd call it a stagecoach kind of rhythmical figure. You can almost imagine. Changing character, you can hear that things, as they should in a last movement, I guess, they're getting more and more intense. But when you hear this repeated figure in the viola, you know that we're in development territory. Explodes into some new material. I said it was sort of a sonata-like form, not actual sonata form. The cello breaks out and does this. And then the viola immediately answers. And so this conversation goes on and on and on, building up tension. Like version of that first theme. So we think we might be getting back into the first theme, but we're not. Margaret takes us, rather than going back and hearing the full exposition again in a proper recapitulation, she takes us to the second theme. I said it was only sonata-like form, not pure sonata form. So we go back into the second theme. Again, in some sort of harmonic, sort of destabilizing mode, we've got a C, C and a G in the cello. We have an E in the viola, and then we have a B and a G. So, for all intents and purposes, we're in C major, except for the second violin, which keeps the B. So the last chord my hands aren't big enough to reach that, but you'll hear that we end in C major, but not unlike the first movement where it was squarely in C major. In the last movement, she chooses to end this piece with harmonic uncertainty, a stroke of genius. that has helped illuminate you into some of the tools that Margaret has used to make this music so harmonically effective. For me, it's those harmonies that actually evoke an emotional response. It's the uncertainty that tugs at my heartstrings and makes me want to listen more. So now I'm going to present the first string quartet of Margaret Sutherland again and hope that you can hear new insights in it this time round. Thank you so much for supporting us and listening, everybody. See you next time.
Thank you. Thank you.